There are few animals more iconic than the giant panda. These bears are the poster children for conservation movements around the world. Unlike their meat-eating relatives, pandas have abandoned carnivory for a diet that consists almost entirely of bamboo. However, in the light of human destruction, specialist lifestyles like the pandas are a risky strategy. It doesn't take much to upset such obligate relationships, and humans are quite proficient at doing just that. But the plight of the giant panda has just as much to do with the ecology of its food source as it does with the man-made destruction of its habitat. Here's why. Essentially giant grasses, the bamboo tribe consists of over 1400 species worldwide. Not only is bamboo the tallest grass in the world, some species can reach a height of up to 40 meters or 130 feet, they are also some of the fastest growing plants. Some have been known to grow about 2.5 meters or 7.5 feet in only 24 hours. As typical with grasses, bamboo can reproduce via underground rhizomes, forming dense stands of clones. Entire forests can be made up of the clones of only a few individuals. The strangest part of bamboo ecology is that they rarely flower. A typical bamboo will live for 20 to 60 years before flowering, with some species taking well over 100 years. Because all clones of the mother plant will flower at the same time, bamboo experiences mass flowering events, with entire bamboo forests flowering all at once. Even the bamboo that was shipped to the other side of the planet to grow in someone's garden will do that. And here lies the problem. After flowering and setting seed, the bamboo dies, which means entire bamboo forests are lost in only a matter of weeks. Whole species of bamboo can flower all over the world at the same time and then die. These mass flowering and subsequent death of bamboo forests probably serve to ensure the survival of the next generation. If the adults were to live through flowering and seed set, it is likely that the thick canopy of the parents would be too much for the young seedlings to overcome. What's more, mass die-offs create a significant fuel load for fires to sweep through. However catastrophic a fire may be, it reduces competition for bamboo seedlings. Before humans fragmented their habitat, giant pandas had no trouble dealing with mass bamboo die-offs. They simply migrated to a new bamboo forest. Today, they can't do that anymore. When a bamboo forest flowers and dies, pandas in the area have nowhere to go. They simply starve to death. Because of this, pandas now occupy a mere fraction of their former range. What intact bamboo forests remain are restricted to the highlands of the Sichuan, Shaanxi, and Gansu provinces. Despite considerable success in the captive breeding of pandas, there are simply not enough habitat to support their recovery in the wild. Because of this, captive breeding programs have come under harsh criticism. It has been argued that the massive amounts of money spent on captive breeding of pandas could be spent on habitat conservation projects elsewhere. No matter where you stand on the subject, there's no denying that pandas fall under the charismatic megafauna syndrome. They captivate the hearts and minds of people all over the world. They also encourage the masses to open up their wallets. Sadly, it is probably too late for giant pandas in the wild. If anything else, they certainly serve as a stark reminder of the importance of habitat conservation on a large scale. One last thing. The script for this video was written by Matt from In Defense of Plants. On his blog and his YouTube channel, he features all kinds of wonderful stories about plants and the botanical world. So please do me a favor and check out his work as well. Links are in the top comment. Thanks.